I always sit weird.
You do. In your socks and your... Yeah. He's always on vacation.
Okay, whatever. Yo, yo, what's going on? Welcome back to the podcast, the Top 20 Man Podcast. Joined me as always, Josh Reef, dating extraordinaire. And today we're going to be talking about how to essentially talk forever.
This is a fun one.
Yeah, this is a fun one. And here's the thing. It's like, okay, well, when it comes to any interaction, business interaction, you know, dating, well, social things, you still want to be a very good listener. That's a separate skill. And you don't want to just talk someone's ear off without having them reciprocate. But at the same time, there's a very special skill. It's a very special skill when it comes to just being able to talk and not run out of things to say. And it's a teachable and learnable skill. Personally, for myself, I used to struggle a lot with carrying a conversation, but now it's just like nothing to me. You know what I mean? And sometimes there is a lot of effectiveness to doing that. You don't want to go overboard with it, but we're going to talk today because Josh and I are both pretty good talkers. You know, especially since we do this podcast and we just talk for hours straight. I mean, we could actually extend it and we actually have to stop ourselves from continuing the podcast because we could talk fucking forever about anything. I'm going to teach you how on this podcast. Go ahead.
Yeah, I wanted to pause a second because there's a lot of like, if you don't want to talk forever with a woman, you're going to, you know, there's a good and a bad to that. But mainly what we're talking about today is how to not run out of things to say. That's the fear. That's the problem.
Yes.
We never run out of things to say. We talk forever here, but I don't always try and talk forever on a date. It doesn't always go the right way that I want it to.
But you should have the ability to.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah. So we'll talk about the ability to talk forever, but mainly how to not run out of things to say. And then if you do, because there's this other misconception you'll probably hear coaches say, like, she needs to talk the most. Have her talk the most. And granted, that would be great if she did all the talking because then she's opening up herself and things are looking good and people like to talk about themselves and she's talking. She's probably really interested in you. It's going to go well. But the reality is most women are not going to do the most talking in the beginning. They'll talk later on, but they're shy. They're nervous. They're worried about being judged. They're not, you know, you're not hooked, you haven't hooked them hard enough yet to get them to fully open up yet and talk. They don't trust you yet. So the few women that will talk your ear off, they're just like chatterboxes. Anyways, they're like social butterflies. So they're women that'll talk. But they're extreme extroverts. And they're a certain segment of women, but a lot of women are, you have to pull stuff out of and get them to open up to you. So we'll talk about how to do that a little bit as well, but mainly when I meet a woman, I'm an extrovert and I talk, I end up doing a lot of the talking in the beginning, but how do I do that without making her bored of me? How do I do that and keep her interested? How do I get her more attractive and not talk about myself and sound like a freaking narcissistic asshole where I'm just talking about me and I don't care about her, or worse, I'm just boring as shit. So how do I, like, what do you do to like not be boring if, like, I mean, you can agree or disagree, but like when you meet a woman, how often do you meet one that's really just talking and talking and talking?
Not too often.
Right? Honestly. They're shy.
A lot of times they're nervous.
They're nervous, they're shy, nervous, yeah. But also they don't trust you yet.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. You know, was it it was like Wolf of Wall Street. He's like, you don't trust me. I'm just some asshole on the phone, but here's what I can do for you. And that's kind of like, it's like you slowly get them to open up.
Yeah. So. You acknowledge the monkey in the room that, well, at least in his case, you acknowledge the monkey in the room that it's kind of weird that you're, you know, opening up to someone you barely know.
It's just honest.
It's just honest.
Like, hey, we just met. I want you to open up, but I'm not going to like pretend like we're besties yet or like we're dating yet. Like, let's have a conversation and I'll show that I'm interested in you as a person. And
yeah.
So a lot of this comes along with like the idea of like actually getting to know the woman versus like just to have sex with her. And you can absolutely go out there, go to bars, go whatever, Tinder, whatever, and meet a woman and have sex with her without trying to learn anything about her and just use attraction and all those other things. But that's not really what I teach. That's not what you teach. And we're really focused on you can have plenty of casual sex and hookups and things like that and actually give a shit about the woman. Like, that's like not mutually exclusive. And you can get more women than any guy out there who's just doing it by this book of step by step and like, you know, treating her as like an object or like just to get the sex. You can have, you can, you know, attract just as hot women or hotter women than that guy. You can get more women, while still actually treating her like a person that you get to know, and then you have a better chance at like getting a relationship anyway. So, you know, I don't really teach that step-by-step, like how to fuck a woman. I teach like the step-by-step how to attract her, get to know her, and sleep with her. Like, it's a whole process of like, you know, and that's, then you have, get into real conversations and she opens up and things like that. So, yeah. So like, what do you do to like, you know, keep a conversation going? Like, why don't you go blank? Yeah.
So here's the thing. This might sound a little counterintuitive, but it's going to make a lot of sense in a second. So actually, I will go blank on purpose sometimes. So here's what I mean. I'll say something, say talk, because there is some truth to some of what the coaches say, where it's like, okay, well, you shouldn't be talking too much. It's more so like who's investing more in the conversation, right? So if you're able to make it so that she ends up being the one asking you questions, it's still good to ask questions for you just genuinely when you're having a conversation. But the power of a pregnant pause is very, very powerful. And here's what a pregnant pause is. 1 second. So if
you don't get her pregnant, though.
Yeah, don't get her pregnant. I mean, you can if you want.
We got to clarify what pregnant pause is.
Yeah, that's not what a pregnant pause is. So so you could just be talking, you know, talking. It's like, yeah, I live in Vietnam. I travel around the world. Being a nomad's amazing, all this other stuff. And then you just stop. Like, stop the thought. Don't ask a question. Just be like, yeah. And then just silence.
Well, holding silence takes confidence.
Holding silence takes a ton of confidence. And here's the thing, more than likely, unless she's like a super, like, unless she like works in sales or she's like a super, you know, self-actualized person already, or she, you know, is super confident or whatever. If you just pause and then you just stare at her, right? And this could be with a girl that you're interested in. This could just be in a business transaction. Could be anything. You just stare at them, but like, you know, not in an intimidating way. They're gonna say something first, and usually they're going to ask a question, right, to break the silence. And when they ask a question to break the silence, then you can keep talking, and then you can just keep talking and talking and making things interesting. And then that way, you can talk as much as you want if you're actually like a real talker. Like a really big talker, like Josh is.
I am, and
I am too, but a little bit to a lesser degree. Then it's almost like, well, they're not going to be like, oh, well, he talked too much. But it's like, well, you're not going to say that if you were constantly asking them questions. You were just responding, right? But on top of that too, so what you actually say does matter. There are some people that say, oh, what you actually say doesn't matter at all. That's complete BS. Of course it matters.
Well,
however,
except when you first walk up. What you say, well, once you're in conversation,
exactly, once you're having a conversation, it does matter. However, you know, I would say that's probably like half the battle. Could even be possibly less, a little bit more, maybe. But there is definitely a lot of sub-communication that's very important. What you do with your hands, different gestures, how you make eye contact is extremely important. So, like, imagine if I was trying to talk to the camera, or I was trying to just talk to you guys who are watching right now, and I'm just, like staring at the floor like this, being like, yeah, you know, I really like being in Vietnam, and it's a really beautiful country, and I don't think I'm going to stay here forever, but I really like the nomad lifestyle. Like, dude, that shit's creepy. You know what I mean?
So, I want to bring this back because I think we're getting a little off topic, because what I want to talk about specifically, because, you know, you can talk about paraverbals, which is how you say things.
Sure.
But I think that's really a different podcast. I really want to talk about the words, specifically the words and the way that the mind functions with the words, because what we're really getting at, and even the pregnant silences, is not, that's on purpose. I'm talking about when guys get stuck and they think, why is your mind going blank? Blank is a state of mind where you actually can't generate a thought and then you can't say anything. It's not on purpose. It's scary for the guy. He walks away because he can't say anything. He doesn't know what to continue. He feels awkward. So it's pretty advanced to offer silence and hold it. It's a really advanced move that's really hard to pull off. Isn't necessary, but it's a cool move to do. But really what we're talking about here is when the fear comes in, and what happens when you really run out of things to say, and she looks at you and stares at you and you look uncomfortable, not like you did it on purpose, because that's what most guys deal with when you go blank. So let's think about, so why do guys go blank? Because let's talk about this. I mean, have you ever, you know, talked to your friend and went blank? Like, you out there, you're watching this, you're talking to your guy friend. How often do you go blank talking to your guy friend? You might stop talking, but you never go blank. Your mind's never filled with no thought of what to say. You may just feel like, all right, conversation's done. but you never feel nervous. You never feel like, oh, what do I say next with your guy friend, unless you're super socially awkward, right? Maybe if you have no friends, sure. But if you got a guy friend, how often do you go blank? You don't. So why would you go blank with a woman but not your guy friend? What's the cause of it? Because it's not like you ran out of things to say with your guy friend. So why would you run out with a woman? It's a fear and anxiety that you're going to say the wrong thing, or that you're going to be boring, or that you're speaking too much, or anything like that. So your mind literally goes blank because you're scared. That's it. It short circuits your thoughts. Your thoughts are like, shit, what if I fuck this up? And you can't say that out loud because your thought is, shit, what if I fuck this up? You can't say to her, shit, what if I fuck this up? So that's why you're running out of things to say, because it's being filled with a fear statement that you can't verbalize because it's going to wreck the interaction. So how do you get rid of that? So there's a few ways. One big thing that I do, or that I like to talk about, is just having a database or a library of things to talk about. And that is what's interesting. It shows intelligence, it shows smarts, it shows passion, it shows a woman wants to join a man's world who's doing things in his life, or that he knows certain things. And so you don't have to be worldly. You don't need to know 7 different languages, but it's helpful to know a little bit about music, a little bit about sports, about science, about religion, about history. Just a little bit, enough that you can have a conversation about it, especially if she's interested in it. Yoga, if she's interested, or veganism, or have your thoughts on the topic. And you don't have to have combative thoughts. You just need to know stuff about it. And the more you read and listen to books and understand and watch certain things, or watch YouTube and learn shit instead of just watching stupid cat videos or whatever, actually learn some things, you'll have stuff to talk about. And so the first thing is build your database, build your library of stuff to talk about, so you won't go blank when she brings up a topic. You won't have nothing to say on the matter. Be like, oh, I read this thing about this thing. You don't have to be an expert on it. You don't have to know a lot about it. You just have to be able to share something about that topic. And so having that database is key, and that's why I can talk forever. And we'll do this in a second. We'll do our exercise. But I can talk forever because I know I've read so much about so many different topics. I have so many different interests. And if you don't have a lot of interest, that's okay. Be really focused on your interest. But I think it's also an excuse. It means you haven't checked out enough stuff to see other things you like. And so I might be able to talk about 50 things. You might have 5, but that's okay. Just expand a little bit. And so have your database.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's really effective too. But one other thing as well is people in general, you know, this is something that you're taught in sales, because I have a sales background, because I worked in sales for years. Usually people only really remember like the last things that you said. Mm-hmm. All the things that you say in between are important, sure, but as long as you conclude it back to the original point. So let's say someone asks you, for example, they say, I don't know why I just keep bringing up my travels, but I mean, I guess that's what I relate most to.
Yeah.
So if someone's just like, okay, you know, how do you like living in Southeast Asia? I would start off with, oh, Southeast Asia, I freaking love it here. It's great. The people are so nice. I truly feel like I've really found the lifestyle that works for me. I love the elephants. I love all this other type of stuff. And let's just say, for just to make it easy, I just go on a tangent on like how awesome elephants are.
Right? Well, we're going to do this in a second.
I know. Yeah. But then let's just say that I do that, right? Because we'll do the exercise in a second. I don't want to actually do it right now. But as long as I can circle back around to the original point, then at that point, it doesn't sound like all the fluff that I had in the middle was completely pointless, because they could all be interesting things that have nothing related to the topic itself. But as long as I circle back to that, and that's the point that I want to get across, then they just like, oh, this guy has this really interesting story about how he really loves Asia. And then, you know,
there is a major risk, though. And the major risk comes in that you're right that most people only remember the last thing you say, but the major risk is that time in between is the snooze fest, is losing them.
So like, it has to be interesting.
Yeah. It's just like doing a 5-minute YouTube video with a great ending. People only remember the ending. But if it's 10 minutes and they've zoned out, they don't even realize the ending even happens once they've zoned out.
Yeah.
So this is the most important thing before, you know, not just going blank, but being interesting and talking. When you have to do most of the talking, you need to do what we call infotainment. It needs to be fun. It needs to be like Netflix or like YouTube or like Hulu or like the movies. Why do people watch movies? Why do people watch Netflix? Do they talk at the movie? No, they receive information. So they're listening to people talk. Why? Because it's fun and interesting. It's infotainment. It's a story. And so you need to become a good storyteller if you're going to talk a lot. Because I talk an insane amount. And if I talked about myself, if I talked about boring shit, I would get zoned out. I wouldn't get any women that way. People are like, either he's a narcissist or he's boring as shit. Okay? So in marketing, and this is sales, this is marketing, just like with women, you're marketing yourself to them. When I talk to women, if I'm going to overdo it, which I sometimes do, and talk too much and don't let her talk enough, I better entertain the shit out of her. And so I'm always focused whenever I'm talking is storytelling. I'm making it fun. I'm making it interesting. Sometimes I'll apologize for the length of the story. I'll be like, no, 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 go on. Because I know how to create hype in a story, create mystery and intrigue. I tell a story like it's a novel or like it's a show on Netflix or it's like a YouTube video. I hype. I leave open loops. I get them curious. I don't tell them the ending. I make it a surprise or make it funny. And so if you want to go on and on and on, there's only one way to do that, and that's through infotainment. That's through making it fun and interesting for anyone who's listening. Now, ideally, you want to bring her in the conversation. You want it back and forth. You want her talking more and more, and that should be your goal. But if she's super quiet and you feel like you got to carry the conversation, make it entertaining, make it fun, and she's going to stay engaged the whole way.
Yeah, and it's really important when you're doing, and we'll get into storytelling all that in a second because that's so true, is you want to bring the person you're talking to into your world, right? You can't just be very surface level being like, I went here, then this happened, that's it. You want to imagine and visualize, and this is why it's good to, like you said before, have a database of some stories in your head of just interesting things that have happened so that you can relive it and then tell it as if you're living it in the moment. You know what I mean? So it's so funny because one of my friends from back home in the U.S., he was so good at this, and I made fun of him for it one time because I forgot what the topic was, but it was so funny because he told the same exact story to like five different people in a row because I was spending the whole day with him because we worked together as personal trainers, right? And so anytime anyone came in, and he was an extremely extroverted guy, and ask how his day was going, he'd be like, dude, you would not believe this. Yeah. And then he would tell it in the same exact sequence every single time. And I made fun of him for it. And he was kind of just like, well, yeah, man, that's just how it happened. And I was like, wait, you're right. That is how it happened. It's just he wasn't adding fluff to it. He was just bringing people into his world, into how he actually experienced the moment. And then that way the people were really highly engaged in what he was talking about because he wasn't just like, I don't remember what this specific incident was. Let's say it was something like, I think this was it. Actually, now I think about it. Like, he was in his car and, you know, some guy was pissing him off. And so they were honking at each other and the guy got out of his car and he got out of his car and they had an argument, right? Okay. That's just like a very surface level story. But if you tell it in the sense of like, okay, yeah, so I was sitting there in my car. And, you know, I just had my lunch and it was raining outside a little bit and it just started to clear up. But, you know, I was kind of in a shitty mood because of that. And I'm kind of really affected by the weather. But anyway, I'm just sitting there and all of a sudden I hear like this really annoying sound behind me. And I realize it's the car horn and I look around. So I'm instantly like just pissed. Right. So I don't know what it is. So I turn around and I see this like really just obese, just mean looking motherfucker just mean mugging me. Right? So at that point, I'm like, whatever, I'm just going to let it go. He keeps honking. And I'm just like, you know what? Fuck this shit. I get so pissed. I freaking open the door. It's still shitty outside. I don't give a fuck. I turn around and go around my car and I confront this motherfucker. And then we start arguing. And this guy's saying a bunch of bullshit. I'm saying a bunch of bullshit. All the cars around us are looking and everyone's looking at us saying like, what the hell is going on? But we didn't give a fuck. So we went at it. I called this guy a fat fuck. He called me whatever. I told him to fuck off. And you know what? I just got in my car and just drove away. But still, this guy fucking pissed me off, right? That's so much more in-depth than being like, yeah, so, you know, I got in a fight on my way here, I was really mad, so, yeah, that happened.
Yeah.
But that's how most people tell stories.
Yeah, and also, I think that's a saying, like, the database, the bank that you're setting up is not just that knowledge base, but it's also a storytelling base. And there's a few things. There's like anytime you can connect a story or bring a story from that data bank, from that someone says an elephant, you got an elephant story, they say a travel story, a food story, you can always bring that from your bank and use that, and you can use them again. And if you've already told it, it's easier to remember and it's easier to tell it the same way. And stories have structures, beginning, middle, end, climax. And so why would you change the formula if you've already gotten laughs from that story, or you've already gotten whoa from that story? Why would you change it? It's like Tarantino. We just watched a Tarantino movie, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and I like Tarantino. He changed his whole formula, and I hated it.
Yeah.
So why wouldn't you do what's working? I think it's a bit contrived to tell the same story to everyone that day or that week. It's more like you're just, you know, planning out your stories, and it's too much. It's contrived. But if you got your database a bank and you're talking to someone, you pull out a story you've told the same way and you tell it the same way again, that's totally legit. It feels normal in conversation. I just don't like it where it's like, oh, every time I approach, I open with this and then I tell this story and then this story. And it's just like, no, you don't have fun that way. That's not how life works. And you run out of material that way. But have the data bank and then, oh, I can use this story here, boom, and then tell it the same way. Then you don't have to think about it. Your mind doesn't go blank. You don't need to change that once it's gotten laughs. Why would you change the joke, kind of thing? But before we get into like the fun game of like, you know, talking and just randomly coming up with stories, I want to talk about the two other reasons that you go blank. So, or the two other like cures for that. So one is that it's called threading or multiple threading, where you go from one topic to another. And it's kind of like a path. So conversations flow in paths, and you get stuck if you like finish your travel topic and then have nothing to go on to the next topic. So the next topic could be like food, because it's related to travel. And so this takes practice, and it took me practice when I met a woman to like say, okay, oh, you know, we're running out of steam of our travel topic. What about the food in Italy, and then the food in New York, and then the food in whatever, and then we get on food topic. So I don't want to just jump to being like, oh, I travel, and then what do you think about climate change? You know, I don't want to jump to this like out of nowhere topic. So I'm always thinking, how do I take this topic, and if I feel it fizzling, move to a new topic, but it makes sense. Mm-hmm. So it's like, oh, you were in Spain last year. Oh, did you go to see the bullfighting and whatever? What other events do you like to go to in your city that are like crazy or fun, or concerts, or like I can, you know, to anything, or the style of dress in Spain that you were traveled in? Do you, you know, is that something like the fashion? What's the fashion in Spain versus New York? And now I can talk about New York if she's from New York. And so I'm always trying to go topic threading, and this takes practice. But the more you practice it, the better you get, and then you won't run out of things to say, because you'll be like, oh, I don't know what to say on this. Let me pivot to a new topic, and I'll just relate it to what we're talking about, and I'll send it in another direction. And when you get really good, when you really advance, you get to, it's pretty cool, you get to dictate where you go. And so I can take any topic, and I can move it to any topic I want to go.
Yeah.
That's like super advanced. And I'm just like playing on a 90 chessboard, where I'm like, I want to get to this topic. So I'm going to start here, and I'm going to do this topic and this topic and this topic and this topic. And then I'm going to get her here, where I want to take us. You know, especially if the topic ends up being back at my place or the beach or wherever I want us to go, I can thread the topics in that direction. That's pretty advanced stuff that I teach. And then the last thing is probably the hardest is, getting rid of the awkwardness and mind going blank by dealing with it, which is really fucking hard. But I did this when I was so close to the edge and I was still going blank, and I would leave when it was going well. I would like talk to a woman, it's going really well, and I run out of things to say, so I'd leave. And so this didn't happen a lot because I was already pretty damn good at this at that point. But when it did, it pissed me off. And I was like, this little piece, I want to solve this. So what did I do? I was freaking insane. I just stood there. And I was like, oh, I don't know what to say. And I dealt with the silence. And then I realized quickly, my brain just filled it in. Once I decided I couldn't leave, and I was like, ah, fuck, I got to deal with this, I stopped being awkward. I stopped going blank. Because the fear made my mind go blank. And once I dealt with that and said, I'm going to just do this anyways, the fear disappeared and I never went blank again.
Mm-hmm.
So I rarely ever go blank now that I've dealt with that fear. So yep. It comes down to fear. But yeah, let's move on and have some fun now. Let's talk about like whatever topic. So you want to start or you want me to start?
I'll start with you. I mean, we could literally just bring up literally any subject, and then you could just keep
going. No, that was the whole idea. We should have had a dice with, like, what's it called? Piece of paper with, oh, let's do that. Okay, yeah. We'll think about it. We can start there, but I think we should.
I already kind of did a little bit with the storytelling thing, but I could do it again, but I'll have you.
No, I want your stories, and I want your rant. Like, I'm just throw it around.
Okay. Well, let's say we were talking about elephants.
Something totally random. The most random thing you can think of. Okay. That's the whole point.
All right. Just because I see it over there, let's talk about backpacks. So what are your opinions on backpacks?
See, that's perfect. So I've had a backpack for like, I think it's 3 or 4 years now. I'm lazy to get a new backpack. It's kind of fallen apart. But I love backpacks because it's like, I don't feel like carrying this whole like sack thing. Like, it looks better, the whole European satchel thing. I'm not carrying a man purse, definitely not doing that. But the whole like European satchel thing, it's like, it looks cool, but it doesn't look that functional. And I can put so much shit in my backpack. Like, it's got all different pockets, and I can take it on airplanes, and it sits there. Now, like, it fucks my shoulders sometimes. Like, I really got to get massages, and luckily Thailand is so close, and I just get that Thai massage all the time. But it's so functional. I'm a very functional guy, and I have like my big backpack that I travel with. If you're a traveler, you have to have like a big backpacker's backpack. My entire life is in there now, like everything I own. And then I put my front pack on, which is like my computer and like all my stuff that I work with. And then I take that out during the day. And then I had a third little backpack that I got that was like my beach pack. Like, it was like small and I could roll it up, and then I'd fill it, you know, I take it to the gym, everything like that. And then that just like ripped apart, and I tried to duct tape it together, and I need to get a new one. It's hard to find. I'm very picky on my backpacks. But I had three. I'm now searching for my, you know, replacement for my third. But I love backpacks, and I think, you know, you can get fancy ones. You can get different colors. My brother actually is an artist, and he designs different items, and one of them is backpacks that he has, and is really cool art. And I just love the concept of backpacks in general. I wish they made some kind of, like, waist strap for some of them, so they would be less pressure on my shoulders. But yeah, I love them, and they've like changed my life. What would I do without a backpack in Asia?
All right, we're done. You see the point.
We had to go forever.
Like, yeah, we should just rename this like the Backpack Podcast.
No. Just like, you could see, I could go 2 hours on backpacks.
Here's one thing I want to take note of. I'm sure maybe some of you guys noticed it, but there are a few parts where you transition from something that, so for example, when you brought up your brother, right? You transitioned into something completely different, but then... But then you went back.
But I could have gone straight into my brother's art. Yeah. My brother's an artist, and here's what he makes, and he's, you know, he's trying to make it as an artist and grow his business and do marketing, and I could go into marketing, and I could go into art. I could be like, are you into art? Have you been to any museums? And then I can be like, oh, that's cool that you know, you want to explore more. Well, I've actually been to Italy, and I've gone and seen, you know, different museums in Italy, beautiful art. My favorite was Michelangelo's David. Yeah. And I saw the Sistine Chapel. And see, when you travel, then you get even more stories and more stories. So now I moved to Italy. And then in Italy, what's, you know, Italian pizza? I mean, New York pizza? Forget New York pizza. I love New York pizza. Italian pizza is the best. Because the freshest ingredients, fantastic. You got to fly to Italy. And I've just threaded. I can go all day on that, right? So, all right. So now I've done my line. Now it's your turn, all right?
Well, one more point I want to say, too. No, we can do that in a second.
Yeah.
Yeah, another thing, too, is it's... Crap, I'm blanking.
That's perfect.
That's blanking. That's not perfect. I'm supposed
to
be.
No, it's a good example.
No, but I mean, it's one of those things where it's like, you know, you tell a story for a long time. It's like you can literally just not run out of things to say.
But
it's freaking amazing. And here's the thing, just threading from one thing to another, one thing that I definitely wanted to point out, and I remember now, is the way that, notice how when Josh was talking, he was using his hands a lot. He was being very expressive, making good eye contact, you know, having facial expressions based on what he was saying.
I also showed the backpack.
Yes, visualization. Again, you have to bring people into your world when you're telling stories. And it's so important to do that, because he could have done that same exact thing and had same exact story, right? He could have even used the same tone of voice, but if everything was monotone and stoic like this, and then, but he was still even trying to have the same inflection in his voice, would have been weird.
Well, it's just like, be like Netflix. Do you watch any Netflix videos where people are boring? No, you watch the actors who know how to do it.
That's a great point.
It's just entertainment. It's infotainment. What do they do? What do like a stage performer do? Yeah. They're emotive. They show emotion. It's not just the words. It's how you use the words. So all the times you're talking, you got to think your paraverbals is actually as much or more important than the words you say. So it's your paraverbals. It's how you talk. It's how you emote. You use your hands and your emotions. And that's what makes it entertaining and interesting. And then, you know, Jim Carrey or Will Ferrell, they could say anything and you'd laugh, right?
Yeah.
And so, or back in the day, I don't know who the new comedians are. But when you have this ability, you need to, so emotion, now you don't want to be too over the top and dancing monkey and too goofy. You got to reel it in sometimes. But when you're in the midst of the story, you want to make it fun and interesting. And when you get good at telling stories, because I've told, you know, I have hundreds and hundreds of stories in my catalog. I sometimes repeat them, but once you've learned the structure and you get good at them, you can improv. And that's, you know, take improv comedy classes if you want to practice some of this, because I've never told the backpack stuff in my life. I've never talked about backpacks that I can think of in my life. No one's ever asked me about backpacks. So what I just did was improv. And the only reason I'm was good at that, not because I took comedy classes, which you should take improv comedy because I think that can help, but just because I have so much practice telling stories that the whole structure and the how to is already so ingrained in me that I just let it flow.
It's
so.
Practice.
So you ready?
Yeah, of course.
All right.
What's my topic?
Topic is Legos.
Legos. Ooh, Legos.
Do you remember, guys? Dude. Do this still exist? All right, go on Legos.
I have some really funny and interesting stories with Legos.
Go for it.
You know, when the funniest thing with Legos is, you know, it's funny because a lot of guys, they're still like obsessed with Legos into their older age.
I played with Legos like 2 years ago at my house. If I had them here, I'd be building them.
It's funny with Legos because it's like this whole spectrum of like, you either have people who are just like 2 years old playing with Legos and then their parents have to like be careful and take it away from them because they just put it in their mouth and start choking on it. Or you have these guys who just are like Lego experts that create freaking like Hogwarts and all this other type of stuff. You know what I mean? It's so funny. Speaking of that, I've never actually been to Legoland, but Legoland, I remember I freaking saw online on Instagram or something, but I remember seeing like someone built the entire thing of Hogwarts, dude. Like, that's crazy.
I've been to one in New York where they have like big dragons and stuff.
Yeah, dude, it's crazy. I mean, can you imagine just seeing like the amount of work that it takes for to build all the Lego things?
Or like the Star Wars like space, what's it called? TIE Fighter?
Yeah, they probably did a whole bunch of things. They made everything, man. And it's incredible seeing, because on the surface, if you see someone who's older and then you see that he's like obsessed with Legos or something, right? You just imagine this like nerdy whatever loser dude.
No, but it's
think
cool.
about it. Yeah, think about it. It's like, think about how meticulous and how much work it actually takes to be able to, you know, take these little pieces, right? And then just combine them together into this beautiful masterpiece that everyone can love and appreciate. I mean, who doesn't like Harry Potter? You know what I mean? And it's just so incredible to see that. And it's so funny because when it comes to Legos, there's this huge spectrum, because on the surface, like I said, you know, when you hear Legos, you think children's toy. But to see actual adults just making beautiful art pieces like that, that then inspire the younger kids who then, you know, the vast majority of those younger kids, they'll probably end up doing something later in their lives. But it might inspire some of them to become like them one day.
Or artists in general. It's an art piece.
It's amazing. So that's why I think it's so cool that, you know, in this world, you can create art out of almost anything. You know what I mean? Even just these little, like, play kid Lego pieces, eventually it can build up to
and
be something
fun.
Absolutely
amazing.
And it's
fun. I mean, you feel like a kid again when you do them. And
I'm sure then at that point it just feels like work. I don't know if you feel like
I feel like a kid. I feel like a kid.
Dude, if you're making an entire thing of
Legos.
Dude,
I feel like a kid. I feel like a kid again when I'm touching Legos. And then like it's a way to connect with younger generations and kids even. Like if I, you know, I was a summer camp counselor and I loved, you know, hanging out with the kids and, you know, feeling young again and around them. And like one of my favorite things to do would be like to play Legos with them, because we kind of get each other.
Yeah.
You know, I'm an adult. Like, I can't share a lot of my world with them. They're a kid. They can't share their world with me. But when we sit down and play Legos together, we really connect on that thing. We both enjoy it. We both know how to, like, mess with them and, like, build little castles and things. And it's fun. And I think it transcends like age and generations and race and like religion, everything. I think anyone can play Legos together.
Yeah, and the funny part about Legos is too, is you can kind of see from a very early age who's going to be the creative kids and who's going to be the more like analytical type kids. Like it, no, seriously. It,
it's true. Personality comes out.
Yeah, a lot of your personality comes out in it. Some people, you know, some little kids might try to create like this beautiful, cool masterpiece and stuff, but because their brains haven't developed too much yet, it might come out a mess, but you know, A for effort, right? And speaking of that, it's just so adorable. It's so cute, I think, when you see kids trying to, you know, act like adults, right? Because nowadays, when we're actually adults now, like we see that, you know, life isn't as glorious now as it was when you first perceived it as a kid. And it's so funny because actually, if you think about it, it's like, well, you know, this entire generation or of people, there's a lot of people that don't have too much purpose. And, you know, if you go on the internet, if you go on Instagram, you see all these memes of like, oh, it was so great when I was like 5 years old. Those were the days, you know? And it's one of those things where it's just like, if you could go back in time and then tell that 5-year-old person, so let's say he's 30 years old now complaining on the internet, you tell that 5-year-old person, hey, you're going to turn into this loser when you turn 30. Imagine what they'd say, right?
Yeah.
But if you tell them, hey, listen, you're playing with these Legos now, and you're going to become a Lego master at 30.
Well, or just something cool, and like an artist or whatever.
Some people, it's unfortunate, but a lot of people, as they grow up, they kind of lose their taste of life, their youth.
Yeah,
I mean, think of why we like children so much and we want to protect them and shield them from bad things in the world, because you could argue that children are everything good in the world. They're just a big ball of potential energy that's untainted. And that's why, unfortunately, too, it's like it's, you know, people, the way that you're raised when you're a kid determines so much of who you become as an adult.
But that was for me, is like, you know, playing with Legos even as a kid, that's how I socialized, that's how I met other people, and not just Legos, other things and sports, and I was engaged in other people. And so, you know, as I grew up and needed to learn dating skill, and that's what I learned in order to become a dating coach, I had social skills. And I was an extrovert from a very young age. And so whether it was Legos or something else, I was playing with other kids and developing those social skills and practicing and practicing and practicing. So what you see, what you guys see with us here and we're talking, it's not unattainable. You just need practice. And I've just been practicing for, you know, since I was a baby. I'm, you know, 35. So 35 years of practice. So you don't feel intimidated by us and our ability to just have conversations if you're impressed, or maybe you're not impressed.
I didn't realize that we're going back to not talking about Lego Mobile.
Oh, you didn't realize that?
Yeah.
That's the trick.
That's the transition.
You didn't even notice.
I didn't even realize it. And I was playing a part of
it. Yeah, it's a little advanced, you know. But no, see, exactly. You're playing a part of it. And I circled back to our topic. And that's what I can do. And that's what you do when you're advanced. But the way that you do that, it just takes practice, and it's not unattainable for you guys. You can do it. You just got to learn the structure. That's why I teach this stuff. If you want to learn it faster, get a coach who knows how to do it, because I can teach you the pathway that I can get it. But I can use that in any way, especially in dating with a woman. I can get her on whatever topic I want. A lot of times it's a way to move the date forward, to go to another bar that I want to go to, or going to listen to music, or go back to my place. I circle all the topics back to where I want to go. Or if I approach and I want to get her on a date with me, and I don't just want to get her number and go home, I want to plan a date with her so she's more likely to actually go on that date. So I'll transition topics to music sometimes, see if she likes live music. I'll be like, there's jazz night on so-and-so, whatever, why don't you go with me? She says yes, then I get the number. She's much more likely to show up on a date than if I'm just like, hey, let me get your number and you know, we'll go out sometime. Now, I do that sometimes if I don't put in the work, but if I know, if I have an idea of a date, I'll transition my topics to that date, get her to commit to that date, then I text her. She's much more likely to show up and agree to that date, especially if she's already said that she likes that thing. Mm. She says she doesn't like jazz music, then I'm like, well, what about punk music? Or what about rock music? And I'll switch to something she likes until I hit it. Because once she said that she likes it, and I was like, I make the offer, she agrees to it. People like to be consistent. They don't like to go back on their word. Nobody does. There's psychology behind it. So once she says, yeah, that sounds fun, let's go out to this place on this date. This show starts at 9. It's a rock band, because she doesn't like jazz. And she's committed to that. So when I text her and she tries to flake on that, I'm be like, wait a minute. You said you love rock music. You already told me you're free Thursday night at 9 p.m. The show's at 9. Like, you can't flake on me now. You already said that that works for you.
Yeah.
And so that's why I do it that way. And that's why I circle those topics back.
I think it's really important to make sure. So just a few things I want to bring up. So it's good to, like we talked about before, it's good to make sure you have a few interesting stories in your back pocket that you can always retell. But having the ability to take any topic and talk about it forever, it's very important, because the number one thing when you're having a conversation is, if you could be like the most interesting person in the world, but if the other person feels like you're not invested in them at all, right? Everyone's favorite topic, whether it's you, whether it's me, is themselves, or something that relates to themselves, because that's how you relate to the world. That's how you view the world, through your own eyes. Everything you've ever experienced is through your own eyes. So whatever relates to you the most, you're going to find the most interest in. So what can be really, really powerful is making sure, first of all, that you're really listening to what the other person says.
Yeah.
And when you're listening to what they say, then you take the thing that they're trying to talk about and extrapolate on it, and then they're going to be even more engaged.
You want to bring a story that they've brought the topic. Exactly. You don't want to choose the topic.
Yes.
Because if I tell a story on science and she doesn't like science, that's bad.
Yeah.
So it's like, again, I love the Netflix analogy. I want to let her click on which episode to watch or which show to watch. I have all these shows and all these movies that are in my brain that I can tell the stories. I want to let her pick her story.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm trying to dig for what she likes, and then boom, I take that story and give her that story and tell it in that way that I know is going to resonate with her, because she's already provided the topic.
That's really how it's
huge.
It's so important. I mean, that's how you have truly magnetic conversations and really help spark interest and attraction when you're talking to someone. It doesn't even have to be in a sexual sense. It could be with talking with like a guy, just a random guy, and you guys end up becoming really good friends, really good buddies, you know? If they're talking about things that are interesting to them, you let them talk. You could ask a question being like, hey, so why are you here in Southeast Asia? And they might be like, oh, because, you know, I really like Vietnamese women or something.
Yeah.
But then they say that, but then they keep talking about other stuff. But clearly when they were talking, the main point that they wanted to get across was that they like Vietnamese women. Then you actually go, hey, I have a funny story about Vietnamese women. You know, I totally agree with that. You know, you take the main point. That's why it's so important to make sure that you don't focus too much on just saying the right thing. You truly try to listen based on and to what they're saying. And then based on you listening, you take the most important topic that they were actually trying to talk about and then extrapolate upon that. And that's how you have truly engaging conversations. That's the art of the conversation. It truly is really listening and talking and having a great dialogue that both of you guys are really interested in. That's the best way to do it, rather than having to think up of stuff, right? Just play along with what they're saying and then, you know, touche from there and then go from there. That's how you have great
And there's not a right thing to say. The right thing to say is whatever is interesting to her,
mm-hmm,
or the person you're talking to. And also you want to make yourself, you know, they talk about like high value stories to make yourself look good. I don't think that's as necessary. It can help. But mainly you want to avoid stories that make you look bad, for sure. And then when you tell a story, you want to position yourself in a good way. You don't have to brag about this accomplishment or that, and that's the danger of telling a high value story, is it comes off as bragging. But you just want to paint yourself in the best light that you can, and that's pretty reasonable. Like, I don't lie. I just try and, you know, whenever I talk, I try and paint myself in the best light without bragging. There's not a need for that. I just talk about it in a way that I'm confident and I know my value in the way, and I don't talk bad about myself unless I'm just making a joke. But just focusing on every story that you tell or the way that you talk, that you're talking about yourself in a high value way, that you believe in yourself, that you have a good positioning on that story. You're not talking about like a story where you're the loser. You know, sometimes you can be vulnerable. That's a whole different topic, but you're mainly telling stories that are good for you, that make her look, you make you look good in her eyes. And then one thing I do want to mention though is the introvert, because some of you guys watching say, well, you guys are extroverts, it's easy for you, I'm an introvert. First off, a lot of times you're not an introvert. That's just a lie. You're actually just shy and awkward. You're usually 50-50, half introvert, half extrovert. That's
how I am. I used to think personally that I was just an introvert. I was just shy and awkward. And for me, I'm more so half and half, a little bit more on the extroverted side probably.
Yeah.
But definitely not a full introvert.
And so it's just an excuse. Introvert is an excuse for a lot of guys who are 50-50 and they're just shy and awkward. And it's an excuse not to get better. So don't let that be an excuse for you. Really, introvert versus extrovert is not about talking to people versus not, because that can change quickly. It's about, do you enjoy being alone? So if you enjoy being alone 90% of the time, you're an introvert. If you hate being alone, like me, you're an extrovert. And if you're somewhere in between, then you're somewhere in between. You're kind of 50-50, which is going to be most of you. Sometimes you like to be alone. Sometimes you like to be around people. The other part of it is, do you like to go to parties where there's tons of people? Or do you hate that and it drains energy from you and you want to go home as soon as you step in the door? That means you're an introvert. If you like to go to lots of parties, you might be an extrovert. And if you like the occasional party, which you probably do, you're 50-50. If you don't mind being in a crowd, but you kind of don't like them, you're probably 50-50, right? And so that's where most of you are, and you're just using that as an excuse to not talk to people. Even if you are an introvert, it's not an excuse not to get better at this, because you should be able to handle one-on-one conversations with a woman. There's no excuse for that. It's very low effort, low energy, whatever. You don't have to go to bars and clubs. You can meet in cafes. You can meet women during the day. Learn how to meet women during the day. You can avoid big parties and big crowds and all these things. Go to quieter places. And you can still have all these same conversations. So don't let introvert be an excuse. And a lot of you out there are not introverts, so definitely don't use that as an excuse. And if you don't know what to do, again, that's why we're here. That's why I do coaching. That's why we do all these videos, is to help you guys learn the right way to do this and the right way to put it together. So I don't want those excuses out there. Learn to get to these conversations, and there's so many ways to do it. And you know, you can learn from, you know, our videos or coaching, or there's also improv classes. I love improv comedy classes. Toastmasters is a speaking seminar thing where you can learn how to public speak, which is valuable. It'll give you practice storytelling and speech giving, which will help you. So there's a lot of resources out there.
And another thing too, so I'll link the group down below, but we have a free Facebook group called Motivated Men. One thing that we can do, I mean, Josh, you run the group, so I think this is something that we could do. If someone really wanted to, because I think the best way to make sure you don't run out of things to say, this is all comes down to environment, right? If you can structure your environment where it's just like, it would be weird for you to run out of things to say. If you do a live Facebook video, you're not going to run out of things to say. I've personally done that for myself. My own business.
Well, in the beginning you do, because like when I started on live video, I feel weird because the person's not there. So I do feel weird talking to camera. And I actually started in this private group where we were like, practice your live video. So I did practicing live video so I wouldn't go blank or run out of things to say. And then I got better and better and better. And then I just started doing my own live videos to get more comfortable on video. So I think just like anything else, if you haven't done it, or if you're not good at it, you can be good at one thing and not good at the other, and it just takes practice to get good at it. So it only took me a week or two to practice up and get good at it, because video was a different medium for me, and I actually didn't feel comfortable on video when I do feel comfortable in person. So it doesn't necessarily translate, because I was like just me and a camera, like you I'm talking to, and camera's there, it's fine. But yeah, when it's just me and a camera, I felt weird at first. So it's just practice sometimes.
Yeah, it's really practice being in an uncomfortable environment. For you, you're naturally like a good talker already, so it's not going to be as effective. But for someone who literally blanks when they talk, that's a perfect opportunity where it's going to feel really weird. You're going to have like so much adrenaline rushing if you're doing a live video, because you're going to be like, you know. So, but I know for me, my best content comes from me knowing that there's not an option to like be like, oh wait, you know, cut, reset. You bring out your true self, and it's a lot better when you can, you know, literally just, you have to say what you need to say in that moment. If you blank, then you look like a dummy.
Well, in some ways, there's less pressure than like when you have to be on, like on a video, and you can't feel like you mess up. Whereas like live video, I feel like I can just babble and come back to my subject. And I feel more pressure on a recorded video where I have to be more clean in what I say and make it make sense. And I can't ramble on because I can't keep their attention in the same way I can in a live video and just come back and forth with it, where I'm just like, oh, I spoke weirdly in this part. Oh, shit, I got to cut that out or something. Whereas live video, I don't freaking
care. But here's the thing. Point is with this, guys, is I can't emphasize enough, and Josh, I'm sure you'd agree, you know, being a good conversationalist is just for life in general, but, you know, especially for dating, man, it's one of the most powerful things you can have. Because if you can really be good at the art of conversation, right, bringing your thoughts and ideas across.
It's the middle game. It's getting her, meeting her to getting laid or to getting a girlfriend, and has that middle part of like that conversation, getting her hooked. And that's a huge part of the game. Giant. It's that middle game that you maybe you can approach and you can get them interested. And maybe you're good if you get on a date and get them alone and, you know, get laid or get them as your girlfriend. But that in between of conversation is that big middle chunk that you gotta progress it.
The things that you say matter. They matter a lot. You know, you have the subcommunication part you need to get down. You have the mindset part you need to get down. And then you also have like the technique stuff, the logistical stuff you need to get down.
And the pair of variables, the how you say it, exactly. So how you emote and use your hands.
Those things. But then also on top of all that stuff is pointless if you can't carry a conversation.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's very, very important. And, you know, you can see so many areas of your life improve if you just become a good talker. Right. So anyway, that's the podcast, guys. That was actually probably one of my favorite ones so far. It might have been my the most fun to do.
Cool.
You know, because we were just shooting the shit, talking about Legos and backpacks and just creating stories off of that. I think it was really cool to do that. And it brought me a good idea. We should do another podcast in the future just on storytelling. I think that's going to be really, really powerful.
Yeah, absolutely.
But anyway, thanks for joining as always, Josh, and thanks for tuning in to the Top 20 Man Podcast, and we will see you in the next one, guys. Have a good one.